brought to you by Penguin.
Bringing Down Goliath, written and read by me, Jolyon Maugham. For Claire, who makes everything possible. What we allow the mark of our suffering to become is in our own hands. Bell Hooks, All About Love. Introduction. The law, backed by the power of the state, is how lawmakers shape the world. It rewards the conduct they like and punishes the conduct they don't. Our lives are shaped and changed by the law. It is the sluice gate through which the river of humanity flows. The law is a slingshot to bring down Goliath. Rich and poor, weak and strong, all are subject to it and equal before it. With it, any of us can take on a global corporation or a mighty government and win. It is blind to power, and it is blind to identity. Lady Justice atop the Old Bailey does not see who appears before her. And no one can put their thumb on the scale she holds, because we can always see that justice is done. At least that's the idea. The reality, I have to tell you, is more complicated. Judges don't wear blindfolds, and their ears catch your vowels. Judging is a negotiation between what the law says and the judge's perception, often founded in their social class, of what value-laden concepts like morality and fairness require. Governments, especially in a country like ours that lacks a written constitution, do place their thumb on the scales. Sometimes the combination of explicit public bullying and private patronage suggests a heavier body part than the thumb. And the cost of asking whether all are equal before the law is an exercise too expensive for most of us. As the 19th century Irish judge James Matthew put it, in England, justice is open to all, like the Ritz Hotel. For most of us, the law touches our life gently. Along with other social mores, it conditions the behaviour of those who interact with us. Landlords, employers, and retailers tend to treat us as the law requires, but mostly because they choose to. The practical reality, for most of us, is that the law cannot be wielded to compel them to. It's a tool too expensive to buy. But that's not true of everyone. Make an enemy who has money, speak an uncomfortable truth or threaten their interests, and you will quickly learn how the law can be used as a weapon to deliver injustice, to bend the weak to the will of the strong. The law should, and it can, protect the weak from the strong, literally. It must discourage employers from abusing interns desperate to enter a profession. It must retilt the scale so Instagram is not financially rewarded for serving up harmful content to children. It must deter the rape of women by men. It fails when it does not, and the unequivocal story told by the statistics is that it is failing. These are real, profound problems, but they should not disguise what good the law can do. The hand of a good lawyer holds the mightiest pen. Its stroke can enlist the power of the state. If your arguments do persuade a judge that a global tech behemoth has broken the law, you can rely on the state to coerce it to comply. It is how far-off corporations are prevented from freeloading on the public infrastructure their businesses need. And if eventually they do pay their taxes, it is the principal deterrent to venal politicians diverting those taxes from the public coffers into the pockets of their friends. It should police the dividing line between what is for the public good and what is for private benefit. If water companies dump sewage into our rivers and onto our beaches rather than invest in infrastructure, it is because the law fails to discourage them from preferring their shareholders. When government gets to buy the votes of MPs and Parliament with constituency boondoggles from public funds, it is because the law has not played its part. Law can help protect democracy. It can prevent a man selected by tens of thousands of voters from suspending a parliament elected by tens of millions. And it can compel him to do what parliament has explicitly commanded him to do. All of these things, I have enlisted the power of the law to attempt or do. The stories of how and of whether I succeeded make up most of this book. Through Good Law Project, I have tried to collectivise the power of tens of thousands of regular people who cannot by themselves afford the hundreds or thousands of pounds an hour that top lawyers charge, to use the law for a better world. The law should mean justice, but it too rarely does. It's into that gap between the should and the does that Good Law Project has sought to step. This means we have to work with what the law is, but I also want it to be better. I want it to work for everyone like it works for the rich. It must work for people of colour like it works for those who are white. It has enormous power to do good, but far too often that power is abused or unused. The law can also help us to engage in the world. Our lives are shaped by decisions that feel more and more remote from us, which are deaf to our cries to be heard, that reveal power to be wielded in ways we know to be wrong, and which insulate the wicked from consequence. And we sense this is getting worse. The temptation is to disengage from it all, to become an acid commentator from the sidelines, rather than a player in the highest stakes game there is. The law cannot be the main agent of democratic change. The fruits of winning control of Parliament are rightly greater than the law can ever offer, but it can be an understudy when Parliament fails to function. It provides some answers to the question, how do I live in this world that is full of things that are wrong and that I want to change? It can hold out the promise of making the things you care about better. It can improve things from how they are. And this is what, as the following pages will tell, I have tried and will try to do. Part 1. How the System Works. Chapter 1. Getting to Now. The life I have is hard, but I got to choose it, and the road that brought me here, I did not. Even before university, I had seen a lot of the world. My mother had me in 1971. She had grown up in Romford and moved to London to study sociology at North London Poly. No one in her family had previously studied for a degree. A mutual friend had introduced her to a novelist called David Benedictus, then famous as the author of an expose about Eton, the school he had attended, called The 4th of June. The relationship was a casual one. He was of a different social class, and although she didn't know it, already engaged to someone else. I have the letter she wrote to him. What this letter is trying to say is that I'm pregnant and you are the father. This is not meant as any sort of tragic declaration. I can't feel tragic. All there is are words on a page from me to you. And I have some of the carbon copy responses from his lawyers and an eventual agreement recording that in return for a payment of £5 per week until she married, she would not allow the child to bear his surname nor in any way represent to any person that the child is the child of Mr. Benedictus. When my mother finished her sociology course in 1972, she moved to New Zealand, following in the footsteps of her parents who had moved there when her father had lost his job working as an office manager for an electrician. There she went to teach a training college and met and married Alan. They had a child together in 1975, and around that time he adopted me. But I grew towards adulthood, believing him to be my biological father. To parent is to fail, as every child, and in their hearts every parent, knows. I could not see it then, the only lens available to a child through which to view their parents as whether their needs are met. But I'm sure he tried. When I was 16, still at school, and vulnerable, they asked me to leave their house. They paid a very small sum of money into my bank account, not nearly enough to live on, until I finished school. I worked cleaning up after my peers at the girls' secondary school, but did not make enough to live independently. I moved in with a teacher from the school, a man who took an interest in troubled boys my age. Several times I shared his bed. I then moved to the flat of a depressed bachelor in his 50s, who alternated between unsuccessful, from his perspective, transactions with sex workers and similarly impotent passes at me. In real life, poverty and dignity don't make comfortable bedfellows. Darning and well-scrubbed kitchen floors are all well and good, but Victorian ideals of virtue are easier to hold to when you rise every morning from a safe and warm bed. The lawyer in me now cannot defend a legal system that criminalizes those who steal because they are hungry. It seems remarkable now, with the distance of the many years since I was 16, that I managed to emerge from this period of my life unbowed. But I also know how I grasped and hustled for chances to improve my financial situation. The way I then behaved to those around me falls short of the standards that I now, more prosperous, set for myself. But I also understand that ideals of morality are something I can afford now, but could not afford then. Sometimes you just survive. Those events have left me with a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.